this last recap video for constraint-based modeling, we will study FSEOF, which is flux scanning based on enforced objective flux, and we will also look at, we will also study the concept of synthetic lethals and how we can, you know, simulate or predict synthetic lethals using constraint-based approaches and algorithms such as FastSL. What is the other important concept in overexpression? We studied FSEOF, flux scanning using enforced objective flux or function, right. So, what was FSEOF? I have not shown you the recent work from our lab. We have used FSEOF twice with great success in two different systems, L-lactis and sunflower. And how does FSEOF work? Let us say you first maximize V prod and you get some V prod star, which I say is same as alpha here for the moment, right. And you then maximize biomass, the usual stuff. You get V bio star. Now you run a series of simulations, 1, 2, 3, V10, right. So, wherein you set up the same problem, right, part of the problem is the same. This is nothing but maximize C transpose V, or which is basically V bio, such that SV equal to 0. LBs, UBs, and additionally we have a constraint V prod equals 0.1 alpha, 0.2 alpha, 0.9 alpha. I do not know if you can pull off alpha, maybe biomass is 0, right. There are cases where, you know, if product is maximum, biomass might basically vanish, right. So, you perform these simulations. So, you have these additional constraints and now you will get some V, V dash, V double dash, V several dashes, right. So, all these flux distributions you now analyze, right. So, how do they look? Or so, this is, these are basically going to be vectors, right. With values for V1, V2, V3, VR. Is that right? Right. And you are going to have 10 or 9 values for these. Now, you take every column that is here and you plot it. Alpha, or let us just call it some, you know, so this will be 0.1 alpha, 0.2 alpha, 0.3 alpha, alpha, 0 to alpha, right. And you plot the flux of V1 or Vj. What are you likely to observe? You can observe many things. You might observe reactions that don't care about, don't, are agnostic about any changes in alpha, any changes in first product flux. You keep increasing the product flux, this reaction doesn't bend, doesn't change. There are other reactions that might always decrease. There are other reactions that might always increase, right. So, the, which of these reactions are now interesting for metabolic engineering? So, the ones that increase, right. The reactions that increase, the two monotonically, right. So, some might, you know, go like this. There are reactions that can also go like this potentially, unlikely, but it can happen, right. So, the reactions that increase are basically the roads admitting more traffic, so that the final traffic has improved. Final traffic has increased, right. So, by reversing that argument, if I widen these roads, if I overexpress these reactions, these genes, I will be able to support more flux in my product, right. So, that is the underlying assumption of FSEOF and it works reasonably well in practice. And how would you quantify the improvement? You can compute a fraction which says V product overexpressed by V product wild type into V bio overexpressed by V bio wild type. So, you might get something like, let us say 3.2 by 2.4 into 0.6 by 0.9, right. So, this might be what you get, for example, right. So, there is some decrease in biomass and some increase in product flux. So, you can rank the different genes based on this fraction.
So, on the bio, for lycopene, biomass will flux will decrease when the product is increasing.
Yes.
So, even that is interesting, right? Even that is. So, using that only, we understood how to increase the lycopene.
Yeah, yeah. So, fair enough, but you want to find, you want to get the maximum. So, what does this say? If I want to have this quantity as high as possible or this quantity, it says that I want the maximum gain in product for minimum loss in biomass, which is fair enough.
No, so when explaining the graph, you told that only increasing is interesting or the decreasing lines are not interesting.
So, decreasing lines are not helpful. So, I am not going to overexpress them and so on.
Oh,
so, they are interesting. For example, one way is, can you like delete those out? Right? Or can you, in fact, one very interesting application, you should go and read about this, it is called flux capacitance. The idea is very cool. You have a metabolic network, right? Can you build bridges or bypasses in that network to improve product flux? This may involve heterologous expression of new reactions, or you know, you need to copy paste reactions or genes from some other organism. But if you built a bypass, which happens all the time, right, in the city. So, you do try to build a bypass or a subway or a flyover, which will help ease traffic, right. The same way, can you improve traffic throughput by building these bypasses? So, one interesting way to build a bypass that we are actually looking at is, can you take these reactions and plug them here? There is a reaction that is sucking away lycopene. And there are reactions that are supporting lycopene. So, can you take the reaction which is taking away lycopene? It is not taking away lycopene, it is probably taking away a precursor to lycopene like pyruvate or G3P or something. Can you reroute that towards lycopene production? It should, right. So, because the reaction is actually taking away some precursors, if you somehow reconnect it back towards, you know, producing some other precursor. Yeah. You can't like basically take the same reaction and put it, right. So, there is basically A giving B and B is taking away something from lycopene. You now convert B to D or something, which is a reaction that goes towards lycopene production. D likes lycopene, whereas B does not like lycopene in some sense. So, you now connect B and D.
So, what if that pathway is somewhat important?
It depends. So, you have to simulate all of those and figure it out, right. So, you obviously do not want it to be lethal or any of those things. So, very well you will find some product forming pathway, I mean some biomass central metabolism pathways and so on there, right. Because if it is a non-growth associated metabolite, that is very likely to happen. And then we looked at the concept of synthetic lethals. Basically, these are reactions where you remove one, nothing happens, you remove second, nothing happens, you remove two genes, you have a lethal phenotype. Same thing can apply to reactions, to higher orders and so on. And we looked at different methods to do this. The obvious easy way was exhaustive enumeration. Double gene deletion in cobra. Right? Better ways are SL finder or MCS enumerator, but both use MILP. The last thing we saw was fast SL, which is basically LP plus L0 or actually L1 norm minimization. You can use L0, but it is slower. So, we said that we will any reaction that carries no flux in the beginning is not going to be a lethal reaction. We will eliminate those and so on and so forth. Lastly, we saw several applications of flux balance analysis, and we also looked at elementary modes. Right. So, the other thing to remember is EFMs and EPs and applications mostly are in metabolic engineering, drug target identification. So, these were the major concepts that we looked at in constraint based modeling. A bunch of additional important concepts we quickly looked at were the concept of blocked reactions, right, to some extent the minimal genome. We will try to do that again in the lab in one of the later classes. Then we looked at flux variability analysis. So, flux variability analysis, essentially if this is your flux cone, this will be convex. If this is your flux cone, this tells you the minimum value for and the maximum value for your fluxes. This is flux variability, right. So, flux variability analysis basically does this. So, if you have a stoichiometric matrix M cross R, how many LPs do you need to solve to compute flux variability? How would you compute this point? Max V 1, min V 1, all the time such that S V equal to 0, etcetera, etcetera. So, you will have 2 R LPs that you need to solve. Right? This will also tell you all the blocked reactions and so on. And remember, of course, very importantly, flux balance analysis gives you an insight into the metabolic capabilities. It does not consider regulation, although we saw methods like RFBA or eFlux to include regulatory and expression data, and there are limitations, right. So, there are cases where you may be predicting false positives, false negatives, right, and so on. And we also, so you remember we studied this no growth, 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 no growth examples and so on. Right. So, experiment predicts there is no growth, but in model you see growth, or experiment predicts there is growth and model you see no growth, and there are a bunch of reasons why this could have happened. This is essentially the whole set of things that we saw under constraint based modeling. So, let us wrap up constraint based modeling with a lab in the evening. With this video, we have nearly come to the end of constraint based modeling. So, I have recapped all the important concepts, and to cap it off today we looked at FSEOF and synthetic lethals. In the next few videos, I have another guest lecturer, Aarti Ravikrishnan, who is my PhD student, who will talk to you about how one performs C13 metabolic flux analysis and how one integrates it with experiments and such as GCMS and so on to predict and quantify internal fluxes in a metabolic network. Right? So, there are many internal fluxes in a metabolic network that cannot be uniquely assigned or easily measured without using labeled substrates, and that is what we will be discussing in the next few lectures.